Hi, everybody. Welcome. Yay! Thanks for being here. I'm Kate Daly. I'm the moderator of the social media in the media session this morning. And I'm really excited to be up here, and I'm excited about our panelists today. I'm going to turn it over to them for introductions, and then I have some brief and general questions, and I'm sure they all have opinions on them. And then we'll save some time at the end for Q&A. So with that, I'll go ahead and turn it over to Kim, our first panelist, for an introduction.
Hi, I'm Kim Lyons. I work at the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette, kind of ride-sharing, and I'm fairly active on Twitter. You might have seen me there.
Hi, I'm Ryan Loew. I am the digital editor for WESA, Pittsburgh's, or the NPR news station here in Pittsburgh. I manage most of our social media, as well as kind of curating our site and doing a number of other things. So.
Hi, I'm Mila Sanina. I am assistant managing editor for the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette for digital operations. I am known on Twitter at PGMila. So give me a follow.
Hi, I'm Scott Harbaugh. I'm Bobby Cherry. I am a reporter, associate editor with Trip Hill Media, and I am on Twitter at GoBobbo, GoBobbo.
I am Scott Harbaugh, and I do weather, and I tweet too much.
That's it. I'm gonna use this mic. I'm Ethan Majoc. I'm with the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette, social media editor. So. Few other projects.
Awesome. Well, thank you guys. And you all mentioned that you are all on Twitter, and I think at some point during today's session, I'd love to hear your Twitter handles so we all can make note of them. So, which social media platform, you know, be it Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, etc., do you find the most effective for connecting with your listeners and your readers?
Who wants to take this one? I'll go first, I guess. I am really active on Twitter because it's sort of quick bang for your buck, and I've done a lot of work covering really dry PUC hearings with Lyft and Uber and all of that, all that's gone on with those two companies. And so being in a PUC hearing, as you can imagine, is not all that scintillating, but trying to tweet out pertinent pieces of information to people who might be interested in sort of the highlights of it, I've gotten a lot of response from that. So I find Twitter to be a really effective way to do my job, but not to inundate people with information that might not be relevant to them. I should probably be a little more active on Facebook. I tend to treat that more like my kind of friends and family circle. But Twitter seems to be the one that it seems like the most natural fit for me for getting bits of information out quickly.
I'll speak mostly for WESA. We're still kind of figuring out what works best for us. I mean, obviously, we're active on the big names in social media, but we mostly are, I'd say, most active on Twitter. We're kind of figuring out what works for us on Facebook. It's kind of interesting. With public radio, you have such kind of a built-in base of folks who just really eat, sleep, breathe public radio. I mean, they're wearing on their shirts, for crying out loud.
And their mugs.
Right, and their mugs, of course. Of course. So, we're kind of figuring out what works. I mean, a lot of times we'll post some stuff that on Facebook that might be an NPR story. It might get a decent reaction, but, man, you post something about, like this new program we're introducing or, Snap Judgment's coming to WESA, and people will go nuts. So, we're trying to figure that out. But Twitter is probably where we kind of, it's where we mostly live, so.
I guess real quick, I live in Twitter mostly professionally. Facebook is there, we use it, but Tumblr too for photos we found is successful, but that's more or less where we're kind of at this point.
I think for us it's twofold. If we're trying to get information out quickly, it's Twitter. If we're trying to gain clicks to our website, we tend to use Facebook a lot more because people will tend to click on the link or video on Facebook, but Twitter, they'll tend to bypass it real quick. And the length stays on Facebook longer in the timeline. So the average lifespan is nearly 10 times that on Twitter. So if we're trying to garner people back to the website, I think we generally use Facebook.
We've actually taken relatively recently to Instagram as sort of a warm and fuzzy platform, almost like, I don't know if it's that we don't have enough following yet, but I think in general in Pittsburgh, it's a much warmer community. Like, there's fewer trolls, I would say. So that's been nice. I mean, obviously the main drawback there is it is, like Scott said, more difficult to get traffic back to your website. So, you know, it's kind of a very little ROI, but it's obviously very important to be active in that space. So
I'm just going to say something that, you know, not in terms of engagement, but in terms of news gathering, I think in Pittsburgh, you know, Pittsburgh community is very interesting on Reddit, and I, as a journalist, love going there and, you know, picking up some ideas from there. It's an essential tool for news gathering. I love what type of discussions are happening there. They inspire some of the ideas for the Digs blog that we have at the Post-Gazette. If you're not familiar with it, check it out. It's at pjdigs.tumblr.com. We digitize our archival images, and, you know, in terms of engagement and just getting some ideas for that platform, we pick a lot of them up on Reddit, and I love how, you know, different ideas pop up on Reddit, in Reddit community of Pittsburgh.
You know, I actually, since you have a mic, I have a follow-up question for you, Ryan. And being that you have basically a parent entity of NPR, I'm curious about how you decide whether or not you're going to post national stories or local stories on your social media feeds.
It's a good mix. I mean, I try to, with not only social media, but also with just our website as a whole, you know, what is an NPR story that I know is going to have impact? That broad enough impact that it's going to affect someone in Pittsburgh no matter what, you know, especially if it's you know, national election or, you know, national issues that will have impact on everyone, really, like healthcare. And there's a lot of good interaction between not only the member station like us, but and with NPR, but also member stations back and forth. A good example of that, and this kind of touches on what Ethan was talking about with Instagram, was a few months ago, there was, I think it was like a Pew study or something came out there where it was talking about why people choose to stay in a certain place, like where they are. And it was actually a digital producer at the Charlotte member station, North Carolina, had this great idea to come out with like an Instagram call out using the hashtag why I stay. And she, you know, kind of emailed a few other member stations, and we were just like, yeah, let's get on board with this. And you know, we just started soliciting, you know, folks to, you know, share a photo on Instagram and with a little bit of their story about why they choose to stay. And so our case, obviously, was Pittsburgh. And we've seen a lot of that. NPR has done a lot of that kind of collaborative kind of Instagram storytelling. Michigan Radio has done a great job with that. So it was kind of, so that was kind of like our first kind of foray into that. And it was pretty successful. Some folks were sharing some pretty interesting stuff, and it all got kind of curated into a Storify.
That's cool. And I love Storify for that kind of, you know, the curation of
right.
it.
Yeah.
And I appreciate you making that reference. And something that Mila touched on was Reddit. And I'm curious about the rest of the panel responding to that and the use of Reddit. I'm a huge Reddit fan. I'm not officially a Redditor because I'm not on there enough. But I do love the Pittsburgh subreddit, and there are a couple others that I find really funny, like Bitch I'm a Bus is a great subreddit. There's a history porn one, which is just all, it's a safe for work historical pictures feed, and it's awesome. So I'm curious, because Reddit is divisive, Reddit has a lot of stuff that you wouldn't show your mom. You know, how do you, as a professional organization, address potential naysayers who would say, like, I cannot believe you would be on Reddit? I don't know if they would say that, but, you know, I'm just curious about your responses to using Reddit for a platform.
I think, like with any, you know, uncorroborated information, you always have to be careful about the source of where it's coming from. I think Reddit's community in Pittsburgh is really great. It's really vibrant, very active, but also very quick to self-police, which I think is sort of a nice benefit of that platform. But I think it's becoming more and more a like a community square, like a place where people go and talk about things. And I, you know, monitor it. I would probably be more active interacting with people on it. But I think the ideas of where you get your information as a journalist have changed a lot. I mean, there was a very big story this past week on BuzzFeed. The editor of BuzzFeed was at this dinner party. Someone from Uber made a really kind of startling comment about how they would, you know, police journalists or try and smear journalists who wrote negative things about them. And a lot of people in sort of mainstream traditional media really look at BuzzFeed as, oh, it's just cat photos, it's the list of you can't even, and you know, the sort of things that they're known for clickbait. But there's a lot of really valuable news coming from places that didn't even exist 10 years ago. And I think to write off something like Reddit or BuzzFeed or, you know, any of the sites that are really doing good journalism is short-sighted. And that's, I think Reddit's a really interesting community. I think, though, with any information you haven't corroborated yourself, you have to be careful about how you source it, how you use it. But I find it fascinating how robust it is and how generous the users are with each other in terms of sharing information.
I just want to add a little bit about Reddit and the fact that I did point out that it was mostly a news gathering tool for us because, you know, I mean, you can promote your own content on Reddit, but it's not a very effective tool because if you're going to just feed Post Gazette or Trib Life links, you're going to be penalized and will not get a lot of, you know, I guess, click-throughs to your pages. But I think that what I find the value of Reddit is that there are people who are searching for information there, and there is a community that is helping to solve problems. I mean, what is the, I guess, the purpose of journalism, right? It's to point out, to show the problems, and also to seek answers for questions on that are very relevant to the community. I think, you know, that reading and social media in general, I mean, it's a private act, right? But it all unites us as a mankind, as the community of Pittsburgh. And I think that this is exactly the value of such platforms as Reddit and as Twitter, you know, as news gathering tools. And I mean, there's much more listening than maybe talking. And I think that's exactly what is lacking with a lot of media outlets, is that it's a lot of talking but not enough of listening, because you sort of paste on your own irrelevance if you think that you know everything. And I think that it's if your outlet, if your coverage is useful, is meaningful and actually useful, then you are finding answers to some of the problems and questions that people have in your community, and you make yourself, I guess, indispensable.
I mean, what's all that? That's fantastic. So, you know, switching gears, we've discussed this in general, I suppose, but how do you feel that you use social media to do your jobs more effectively? I know that Mila's really touched on that, but I'd like to look to some of the others to, like, you know, maybe 15 years ago, I'm suspecting that a lot of you are young in your careers, but, you know, 15 years ago, we didn't have these outlets, and when you were getting a job in, you know, the public, you were not expected to have a Twitter account. So how do you feel that you use it to do your job more effectively in today's world? And how do you think that that has changed from how you may have done your job before?
For the most part, my professional career has been with social media. 15 years ago, I was in high school, so.
Oh, no. Ew.
So I don't actually know. I mean, when I, you know, going through journalism courses, you always were taught, you know, to have, you know, grow your sources, know people, you know, get to know people in the community, which I still do. But being able to instantly see what readers are talking about, or just now, you know, someone from WESA was talking about a crash on 79, and I wouldn't have known that otherwise, you know. So I think it's kind of just being able to have sources that will come to me with information, but then also being able to just generally see what the public is offering, you know, from their perspective. They hold us accountable, they provide us information, so it's become more of a two-way street. From what I gather, maybe life was like in journalism before social media.
Kim's dying.
I remember the old days before we had them internets. I came up as a journalist before the internet was really, before email was really widely used. And I remember the old day text machines. And I remember using a phone book to try to find sources and actually going out in the community. I think Bobby can snicker all he wants, but it was a very different way of doing the work. And I think in some ways, social media, if you're not interacting with people, if you're just broadcasting your own work, you're not doing a good job. And I think sometimes you lose a little bit in the interaction. If you're not going to someone's door and knocking on it to get reaction to a story you're trying to work on, I think you can use it as a tool to discover things and find people, connect with people, but I think it's only a tool. It can't replace verifying information, going and talking to someone in person, you know, sitting down in their office to do an interview with them rather than trying to communicate over the phone or via email. I think it's a really great tool. I've used it and experimented with different ways of using it, especially Twitter, but it's only one sort of weapon in your arsenal, if you will, to getting information and doing your job effectively, I think.
I'm from Kim's generation, and it has changed immensely. And I said this the last time we did a panel discussion, or I was involved in a panel discussion. I was told 6 years ago, you're going to do this thing called Twitter. And I said, no, I'm not. And now it is the reason why I'm still at the station. There have been times where we could have cut people from the weather department. We could have changed people. And I have kept my job and finally moved into mornings, as I was told, because I have a social media presence. Because that's how most people are getting their information out. Even though, and Bobby was talking about this in an email between the group of us earlier in the week, even though the numbers are still really low for who gets their information from social, from their phone, from their iPad, it's still 10 times greater than it was 2 years ago. And it's going to continue to grow. We just hired someone 2 weeks ago. Their sole job purpose, 8 hours a day, is to scour every bit of social media and find news. That's their job, 8 hours a day. Man, we're paying this guy like thousands and thousands of dollars to do this. And I'm like, wow, this is how it's changed. And unfortunately, there are the people that aren't in Kim and my generation that are like, well, this is the way it's always been. And then there are people that are older than Kim and me that are still like, I'm not doing this, and they will be left behind.
Just add real quick. For us, it's been, especially on Twitter, it's been a great kind of natural extension especially for our live show, Central Pittsburgh. Where they're able to really solicit, you know, before, during, and after the show comments. And we've seen some really great success for that, especially when we have guests. A great example is when we have Mayor Perduto on once a month. And we get some really, really great dialogue happening just on Twitter alone, let alone what's actually happening in the studio. And it contributes to that. You know, Paul will throw to some, you know, to questions from Twitter. It is on a regular basis, but especially in those kinds of circumstances, it's a really, really great use of that tool.
That's awesome. Yeah, that's a great show, and I had thought about that.
I had a couple questions come in via Twitter.
Awesome.
Just
sure.
There, that's okay, and I'm going to direct this one to Bobby, since he said he lives on Twitter. How do you balance work life when you live on Twitter? I mean, you know, how often do you check your phone? Obviously, I've been checking it pretty obsessively while I'm sitting up here talking about using Twitter. So, you know, how do you balance? When do you get to that point where, okay, I have to unplug? Or do you get to that point? I don't know.
I don't unplug unless the phone dies. Last night during light-up night, my phone died and I didn't know what to do.
Did you have like a panic attack?
I had forgotten the portable battery, so I couldn't take any more photos of Santa.
That's like
night.
A Bobby shirt crisis right here.
But, I mean, truly, you know, I don't tend to, well, even when I'm not working, I mean, as a reporter, we're always working, whether we want to or not. But I think with social media, it's really heightened our awareness of news. So at 11 o'clock at night, I mean, we're all sharing stories on our work accounts if we have separated work and you know, professional accounts or whatever the case is, but we're still sharing stories even off the clock because we're trying to be social, we're trying to engage our readers, all of you, so that we can build the human aspect of who we are. You know, Kim, you'll share stories not related to Uber and Lyft, you know, a lot of the time. And it allows people to see, you know, some of your interests. So I think there are reporters who turn off the clock. You'll see them tweet during their work hours and that's it. And it's kind of awkward. It's almost robotic, I think, when people do that. You know, so I think there is no dividing line between the work-life balance, at least for me.
Yeah, I think though sometimes you get into a problem of quality versus quantity. You know, we have on our staff, he's not super active on Twitter, but his name's Dan Gagler, he works in our sports department, and whenever he tends to take really nice Pittsburgh-y photos with his phone on his Instagram. He took one when the fountain at Point Park was reanimated last year, and it was, Mila, I might be wrong about this, but one of the more shared, not most shared, you know, photos we had on our social feed. So I think an argument can be made for you have to stay active, but maybe not. I mean, I think I overdo it a little bit. Maybe I could, you know, take a break. But you know, quality versus quantity is something I think you struggle with. You don't want to be kind of on all the time and constantly, you know, tweeting, constantly at people. But by the same token, you don't want to be left out. So you have to find that, you know, where is the quantity quality
line? And I think right now the difficulty I see myself having is, there's, like, I follow, I think, 2,000 people. Mm-hmm. So if you follow 2,000 people, I could tweet 20 times a day and you wouldn't see any,
yeah.
You could
yeah.
run the risk
yeah,
of not
true.
Seeing any of my tweets.
Yeah,
and
right.
I have people who say, I don't ever see your tweet.
Not seeing your tweets is not a risk.
But I mean, you know, that's you know, so you run the risk of you know, people talk about building their personal brand, you know. I know, but if you are trying to do that or whatever the case is, if you want to build an audience, you have to sort of find that balance to tweet, and not to tweet news, but to tweet other things too, like that Pittsburgh photo, you know, like that's not really newsworthy,
yeah, right.
but it's a balance between news and outside life.
I said all I need to say.
Okay, cool. So tell me about potentially you may have colleagues, you may have family members, you may have friends who are not on social media, do not see the value, criticize you for never putting your phone down, you know, use words like obsessed, and you know, how do you try to change their mindset, or do you take that challenge on? Do you try to persuade them to think differently about it?
You cannot cry until you try. So you know, that's, I guess, you know, you can't. I have said it many times. Unless you actually give it a try and give it time and commitment and try to understand it and ask for help, you cannot criticize it. We hear it all the time about how, you know, it means that you are completely changing journalism field to make it less, you know, less engaging, less, you know, community building, meaning that this people have very short attention spans. They're on Twitter. Why should we follow suit? Well, I mean, you know, like as a manager, you always wonder, do you spend time with people who give you most actually return, or do you spend time with people who might not, and spend a lot of time who might never be buying into it? So how do you, I guess, strike that balance? I mean, sometimes I do have to say that we try to give a chance to everyone, and sometimes it takes time. But a few times there are good surprises and good returns, even if, you know, even if it's not it's not very good at first, but then they improve, and you know, Twitten becomes very good. And I just think that if people are willing to try and to give it a chance and be, I guess, an adopter of, you know, adopter of new technology, that makes a difference. So I'm willing to work with them. But if you are already, you know, come with an attitude that, well, I have to do it, and so show me, how do I open my account? And then after 3 years, it's still an egg, and it still, you know, has two tweets from 3 years ago. So
I know we need you.
Yeah, we probably have a solid balance among the sort of elder statesmen at the Post-Gazette of people who adopted it and did what Mila just described, or took it on, or just totally ignored it. And one of the most recent pleasant surprises was actually our editorial page editor, which was someone who I never would imagine would jump on, Tom Wasileski, and I think he's Tom Waz on Twitter. His feed recently has been very good. He shares sort of all the day's opinion content, letters to editor, that sort of thing. It's really kind of taken off, and he's very engaged. He tweets at high traffic times of the day, that sort of thing. So that was really surprising. And also one of the strategies, I guess, to kind of leverage people is to actually play on their frustration with their job. Our photographers are perpetually like unhappy that their photos don't get like the top play or whatever, and so actually we had a recent staff meeting and that was sort of made known, and one of them described, well, this is actually really great, like I'm totally in control of the editing of my photos and the posting and prominence of them. So you know, from that standpoint, that's, you can kind of manipulate them into doing it a little bit more, I guess. So very subtle though.
Persuade, yeah. Well, with that, I always talk to people who are, I call them Luddites, when it comes to this. And I have been forming a blog post about that, so this is actually fueling some of that for me. So, trolls. I mean, we touched on Reddit. Reddit is not the only place where trolls reside. They go trip-trapping in most of our social media platforms. What's your experience with trolls? How do you handle them? What do you do when that happens?
Start off kind of talking to them like a child almost, like, okay, I understand, you're upset. Be very civil, obviously, but to ultimately, like, try to understand if they have a legitimate concern. Some people are just trolls, they're taking something out on you. And those people you kind of have to let swim on by. The ones who do have legitimate concerns, we try to respond to them just in a, you know, very fact-based, level-headed way, and some people are kind of lost causes. So I don't know. What do you? You get a lot of trolls at WPXI. I'm very aware. So
strategy.
Yeah, matter of fact, I'm talking to one of my trolls right now. Because, but I was talking to him because he sent me a picture of the accident on I-79. Numerous cars on I-79 northbound and southbound due to the freezing rain this morning. So that's what we're talking about. This actually is a good time because this kid was the biggest pain in my life. He's a Moon High School student. He's a senior this year.
Not me.
A couple years ago, he tweeted to me, I was off, and he tweeted, any chance of rain at 4 o'clock, I have a baseball game. And I said, not sure, I'm not at work today, so I don't have great information, but I think it's going to be after 4. And he said, what effing good are you? And I said, I hope it pours on you. It ended up in Pittsburgh Magazine. It got 480 retweets. I got 2,000 new followers. I mean, those that know me know that I have a very short leash on what I'll let somebody get away with on social media. I used to take to blocking people, but then I started getting all these, please let somebody, you know, follow you again. So now I just mute them. The mute button is the greatest button on the face of the earth.
That's a good button.
Yeah, so I don't engage them as much as I used to, but once in a while the high school kids, because I've discovered as I'm getting old, shut up, Bobby. Discovered as I'm getting old that I'm like, I have like less tolerance for high school kids who think they're cool. Like most high school kids, 98% of the high school kids that follow me, I'm very fortunate to have a solid number of followers, but half of them are high school kids because they want 2-hour delays if it's 70 degrees outside. And most of them are great, but there are a couple that are just like, they think they're cool, so they like to drop F-bombs my way, and I just, you know, I have low tolerance on that.
So you're less than civil,
yeah. I'm a smart aleck to them, and my bosses are aware, and once or twice in 6 years I've gotten called in and said, that's the line. Yeah, they're like, that's the line, don't cross it. I'm like, okay, at least as long as I didn't cross it.
That's true. Any other troll talk?
You know, there's we haven't really discussed the comments section on different websites, but it's been a very a troll problem has been an internal problem. But you know, you actually learn a lot from them because you learn about the topics that inspire conversation. They're instigators. They attract a lot of a very long time on page. Their engagement fuels the conversation and results in very long time on page. But, you know, we hear, with a lot of comments, especially commenters, especially those who are representatives of those who talk about our letters to the editor. This is another interesting example, right? Letters to the editor used to be the only way to connect with your newspaper. Now it's letters to the editor that instigate the conversation and very heated discussions. So, I know almost every single one of them, you know, and I would remember which topics they talk about. Oh, this guy likes to talk about bike accidents. Okay, this guy is about climate change. This guy is about NRA. But it's, you know, it's very informative, and I think that you can glean. I wish I had more hours in my day to glean more information and good feedback on what kind of topics generate those conversations. Sometimes, you know, there was an interesting idea that I've been thinking about is, well, with those letters to the editor, especially during the fracking debate in Pennsylvania, we had a lot of people who seemed like, you know, they, every time we write an editorial, an article, or there is a letter to the editor about fracking, there would be the same people that would show up. And then there would be responses from our community members who are very engaged, and they would write to us saying that, you know, you should notice the pattern that these people show up only when there is a conversation about fracking. So there is a question, right? Where do they come from and how do they find this content? We don't know much about them. But I guess, there is value in discovering the topics, specific topics which attract those kinds of people. You know, I mean, as far as I know that there are a lot of reporters, unfortunately, one of them is Melissa McCart, who repeatedly, she's our restaurant critic, and she has struggled with trolls in an unfortunate, there are conversations that are just so hateful and absolutely aggressive and unreasonable, and it even inspired a conversation about, you know, how do we protect our female reporters on social media against those, you know, like even threats and attacks? You do what you can to equip them with tools and also to protect them. You know, we have had that issue. We block people who do not abide by our, you know, by our rules, by our guide to commenting, but it's been an issue. I think there is value, but it also has been presenting a lot of challenges.
Very interesting. So now we have a handful of minutes left, and I'd like to open up the floor to questions from the audience. And I'm wondering with Kim if there are any additional ones that have come in over Twitter.
So there's a couple that are around the same subject. Brands and regular Joes, how can we connect with you on Twitter? I think if I haven't talked to you or you haven't emailed me or we don't have any kind of interaction previous, approaching me on Twitter with, hey, come to my event, is not the way to go for me. I don't know how, if I can't speak for other reporters, but you know, I wouldn't expect someone to only, if there was an ongoing conversation, if I put out a question on Twitter and someone replies, that's one thing. But if someone approaches me with an event or something they want me to cover, you know, I don't want to embarrass anyone. I don't want to make anyone
feel uncomfortable, but that's not the immediate doing, because if I say no, well, there, I've said no publicly right there, and maybe they feel a little embarrassed, or they have their feelings hurt, or whatever, but, you know, feel free to approach me, say, you know, I have something, can I call you, can I email you, that's fine, but I don't think you should expect an immediate response to the initial approach being on Twitter. I just feel like that's not really the best way to introduce yourself. Maybe to introduce yourself, but not to perpetuate a conversation, for me anyway. So I don't know how other people feel about, someone wants to, find out if school is closed tomorrow, that's one thing. But if someone wants to talk to Scott about, hey, we want to do a feature on this event, you probably want to take that conversation off of Twitter and have more of a discussion about it rather than back and forth. So that was one of the questions that came through. And then another one was, what platforms, I'm trying to find it here because it was a really good one. It's from Will, my co-conspirator on the David Conrad videos. He said, what are some things that you tried that, what tool do you find most difficult to use but continue to use? And for me, I think I had an iPhone that I found so difficult to use, I get rid of it. But I think I find Reddit to be a challenge. I think that I know it's something I should be using more, but I do find it to be a little bit daunting because I don't want to make a misstep and get shunned or whatever. I feel a little bit intimidated by it sometimes. So that's one I think that, if I'm being honest, I know I should use more and could do more with, but I feel a little bit like I want to make sure I'm not violating the rules. It's very sort of unspoken etiquette to using Reddit. So that's one thing that maybe, I try to keep using even though I feel a little bit difficult. So.
As far as tools that kind of struggle with Google Plus, no earthly idea what to do with it. Somehow we have a following, and I post to it, and I contribute, or I post our content to it, and it just somehow, I don't know.
Everyone there uses Google Plus. Yeah, okay.
I remember when it came out and I was so excited about it because they had this really emotional commercial. Like I would cry at like a diaper commercial, and then I saw the Google Plus thing with circles and they were doing hangouts and I was like, oh my God, this is gonna change it all. And I was excited for like a day and a half. And then I was like, yo, there's nobody here. It's like, there's tumbleweeds.
Like Elo.
It's like Elo, thank you. Oh my gosh, I was so into Elo for 3 days at the end of September.
Yeah.
3 days. Yeah. Yeah, and then now I'm like, I don't even know if it's still there.
I can't access it from my phone, so I don't
care. Me either. That was their biggest Achilles heel, in my opinion. The fact that they didn't focus on a mobile strategy from the start, I thought was a mistake. But do we have questions from the audience in here? No. Oh, that's cool. That's cool. You can tweet them. Hi. Yes.
Hi. How can citizens suggest stories to journalists?
Great. And to repeat it to the group, in case you didn't hear, how can citizens suggest stories to journalists?
Well, really,
citizens should be the people who are suggesting stories to journalists. It shouldn't just be up to us to decide what the news is, right? So how can you suggest a story? Call me. Send me an email. It depends what the story is. A lot of times I get suggestions for stories or pitches for stories that just aren't a good fit or aren't something I'm really going to pursue. And I think a lot of times PR folks get discouraged by a no doesn't mean no forever. It means no, not right now, maybe next time. How can citizens get information? Our traffic reporter is very active on Twitter, especially during the rush hour in the morning, PG Traffic, John Schmitz, does a great job. And he's very engaged. He retweets other traffic reporters. He retweets people giving tips about water main break or traffic or what have you. I think it depends on the reporter. It depends on what you're pitching. But I don't think people should be intimidated to try and approach a reporter. I mean, there's some, perception that reporters are untouchable or unapproachable. And I think that this panel right here is evidence that we're not. That, it can feel intimidating, but it shouldn't. Make the approach, you send me an email, call me, approach me on Twitter and say, hey, can I call you? But I think citizens should be who are telling us where stories are, where the news are. We shouldn't be the only ones who determine what's news. We should be getting your input and your feedback. So,
Bobby Cherry, you look like you have an opinion on this.
I thought about saying something. So it's sort of, It goes back to what journalism was all about. We depend on readers to tell us what is happening or what they're doing. And that hasn't changed. How they tell us, it has changed. You know, the phone, Monday morning, I'll go into work, I'll have voicemails, I'll have email. There's probably tweets to my Trib account that I haven't checked yet this weekend. You know, so people, if people tweet me and say, hey, I have the story idea, I will reply and say, here's my email address, shoot me some info. If they call me, then we'll talk on the phone. If they email me, then I'll just say, hey, can I have a phone number to call you? So it's kind of the same thing. It's just reach out to us, and maybe I'm not the best fit for whatever you're pitching, but if someone else is in our company, if we have a beat reporter or something that I can offer that to, then I certainly would forward that on. But the way in which readers reach out has expanded, but at the core of it, it's still the same. You know, we depend on the readers to tell us what's going on.
And I was going to say one thing not to do, definitely not to do. Do not send a blank impression list to every reporter in the newsroom. That is the quickest way to get it in the round pile. Know what you're trying. Like, if you're, you have a story about ride sharing, I cover ride sharing. Get to know who is the reporter you want to contact. Don't just blanket the newsroom with a press release, or don't send it en masse, because that our filters are probably going to catch an email anyway. But know which reporter. And if you're not sure, if you have a reporter you've worked with in the past, you know, I have this pitch, it's probably not you, but who at the PG would be good? Because I'm more than happy to direct people to, you know, others in the newsroom who might cover something that isn't in my, you know, my area of expertise or my coverage area. John, you have a question.
Actually, you were starting to answer it before I asked it, but so is the press
She's
release...
that good.
Is the press release dead?
Is the press release dead? That's a whole other session, isn't it? I don't think so necessarily. I think, though, I get so many pitches we have this new brand of coffee. Would you like a free sample to write about? I'm like, when have I ever written? You know, but I mean, I think it's if you're sending a press release, you know, public service agencies could be able to send press release, like Mayor Peduto's office does, and the state police do that. And so that's a way for them to get a lot of people who want that information all at once. Brand sending press releases, I think it's a lot trickier. I wish I had good advice about what to do, what not to do. I would say the one piece of advice I can offer is don't approach, you know, the wrong reporter with a pitch and expect them to, you know, act on it. If you're approaching a reporter that you have a relationship with, who should I ask about this? That's one thing. But, you know, blanketing with a press release, sending it out en masse, it's not going to, very unlikely that it's going to resonate with any reporter or editor. You can always call. And call the business editor and say, hey, I don't know which reporter covers this. We have this X, Y, and Z event. Can I send you a press release? You know, because then they're watching for the press release to come in. But is the press release dead? That's a really good question that I don't really have a good answer for. I'm sorry. What do you think, Bob?
I think press release is not dead, but I think what matters, boring writing is. You know, I think that it actually matters how you present the idea and what's new. I do think that, you know, I mean, a few years ago, we've been talking about how newsletters are dead. Look at what, you know, Eat That, Read This do with the newsletter. I mean, it's a fascinating, I read it. It's a must read every day for me. It's one, you know, Adam Schock has completely revolutionized the newsletter for the city like Pittsburgh. I admire this guy for what he has done with the newsletter. Organizations like ours, Pittsburgh Post-Gazette's newsletter is not the most engaging newsletter. And it's not good, it's not interesting. We are not very, we allow someone like,
this is being live streamed,
true. Adam Schock has done, is really, his example is humbling because, you know, he just puts together, you know, a very good compilation. This is one newsletter you honestly should read every day, and you will get what you need to know for the city of Pittsburgh, you know, 5 days a week. But, you know, I mean, I'm not denying that our newsletter is not interesting. It's not, because it's not, you know, it's not. It's a robot.
don't send
so
a
I
lot
guess
of
it's the
releases.
Same for, you know, press releases. Sorry, I was like
Brian, did you want to
Oh, no.
Okay. We are about coming up on time. Yes.
Okay, so I'm going to add it to my original question.
Okay, cool.
But also maybe open it up to the group. How do we get the press and the community to dig a little bit deeper on a story? And I'm going to give an example. So I'm on a one blogger quest to change the conversation around the produce terminal, just because I happen to have a conversation with somebody, and it's coming up for vote that the URA could sell off this 100,000 square foot building. But there's like no good place for me to go and get the whole story, right? You all do wonderful research. There are several articles over decades about the produce terminal, but it's nearly next to impossible for me to get that all in one place. And
why don't you have your own blog?
What?
Why don't you have a blog where you say
I do. I write the blog I Heart Pittsburgh. Okay. I don't get paid to write.
Hi.
I don't get paid to research. I don't get paid to write. And I'm not a writer. You're a journalist.
Why are you not a writer? Why do you say that you write every day? You have a blog, you're very active.
You're a writer.
My high school English teacher told me I'd never write anything.
Well, how
did
you? I'm going to you after that.
No, but it's not my job to research. I mean,
why
I don't get paid because I
okay.
get paid by
but if you feel passionately about this issue, you clearly
do. I
do.
But I'm trying to bring up a conversation about how we can better organize the great research that you've already done around some of these topics so as citizens we can better educate ourselves. So I'm just opening this up as a discussion because I think there's incredible content. You all create much better content than I do.
I don't know.
And how do we synthesize it in a way that's more useful? Because right now I'm sort of struggling to take what research has already been done and bring it into one place. So I'm just opening it up for discussion.
Yeah. Awesome.
Can I just say one thing? You're onto something that has been a big question in digital media in general. And I think for in any digital website, news website, that has been, you know, watching what has been happening to digital journalism in general, is, you know, is struggling with this. Because with Wikipedia, in a way, solved it. Because they have thousands of editors who update the story on one topic faster than any news organization can. And they rely on a huge community organizing knowledge. Our big challenge, and people at Vox.com, at, you know, all these new digital ventures are struggling with it, as every single newspaper, because we do not know how to organize knowledge. That's our biggest challenge, you know. We try to do that, like with Uber and Lyft. For example, Kim took it upon herself, to give an example, to have a landing page where all the content is basically structured. Like, these are the stories. If you want to know what the status of Uber and Lyft and ride sharing in Pittsburgh is, that's where you want to go. But with, like, Produce Terminal, we don't have that page. With the August Wilson Center, you know, a long controversy and different, you know, motions, we do not have that landing page. We don't have a way for people to, you know, for people to come to one topic and say, to one page and say, oh, this is the page that where I can find all the information and be up to date to what's going on that issue. That's a dilemma. I don't have an answer to that. But this is definitely something that, you know, I would love to hear your opinions. But also, you know, this is something that we have been thinking about and been struggling with. So, you know, it just shows that, that, you know, our community is also being unfortunately underserved in that regard, because we can write articles every day about one issue, but we cannot expect people to be reading every single article, because it's impossible. If you publish every day 130 URLs, you think that somebody, you know, as the Post Gazette does, you think that there is one human who is capable of reading every single one of your story, and why would they?
And they're going to write a letter to the editor about every single one.
Exactly. So, you know, I don't have an answer, but it's an excellent question. It's one question that I think will define what the future of digital journalism and organizing information in the digital space is going to look like, especially for local entities like ours.
Yeah,
That's awesome. Yeah. Yeah, what can we do to all of this? But I do, however, I would love all of us to share your account, your handles, where you want people to find you on social media. If you have a personal account and want to share that, that's awesome. If it's a personal as well as a professional account, awesome. And we only do have, three favorite Pittsburgh blog, FB page, you know, Google Plus Alley, whatever it might be that you would recommend to people as a must-follow account or a must-follow blog. So, start with Kim.
Okay. I'm on Twitter, Social Kimley. It was supposed to be a joke when I made up the name Kim Lai. It was J Lo, but it never caught on. So, that's funny.
Here you are.
Yeah, so you're still trying to explain it. So I'm on Twitter. I'm fairly active, and I try to be responsive if you ask me a question or if you have a question about something I've written. Who do I like on local? I really like Scott Harbaugh. I think he does a really great job, not just because he's sitting two people away from me, but he does a really good job engaging with his brand. He's a meteorologist. He does weather. He interacts with people, and he knows who his audience is. I think he's a must-follow. I've often asked him if he could hold off weather for me for certain personal purposes, but he doesn't have that kind of power. I think there's a lot of really good Tumblr blogs. I wish I could name all of them. I really love the digs. I love what Mila's done there with archival Pittsburgh photos. Ethan also has done just a lot of really great work with digitizing our photo archives. And I think, someone who he was a big part of, I said this last year, I think, too, but he was a big part of Podcamp in the past, Mike Wojcik. I always follow him because he's another quality, not quantity. He doesn't tweet as much as maybe he used to, but he's got a lot of good stuff. And Bob and Mikey from the KISS Morning Peak Show, they're so funny and they're so engaged. I think they really do live on Twitter. So I follow a big variety. I think there's a lot of good stuff in Pittsburgh social media.
I personally am at WESA Ryan. The station is at 905 WESA, and our Essential Pittsburgh is at ESS PGA, so please be sure to follow all those if you can. As far as local, I think our two hosts, Josh Rollerson in the morning and Larkin Bates Jacobs in the afternoon, both do a really great job. They've really, especially on Twitter, they've done a great job of taking the role, I think, as a host when they're really good at curating all this different national and local news. And they do it on Twitter just really, really well as well. So I definitely cannot follow those guys. Please do as well. But beyond that, as far as national Twitter handles or Tumblrs, NPR's social media desk, if you're interested in any and all things social media, especially as it relates to the news, I definitely would recommend checking out their social media desk Tumblr. It's where they offer some just really great best practices, just kind of behind the scenes stuff. It's a couple folks who run it, but most notably Melody Kramer is just she's absolutely brilliant when it comes to social media, so I absolutely would recommend following her as well.
Thank you. I do like Larkin Page Jacobs on Twitter. But I will have to give my vote to to Adam Schuck. Very grateful to this guy for defining how we should be changing, how the media should be changing. I'm on Twitter at PG Mila, and Pittsburgh Post Gazette is Pittsburgh PG.
I am on Twitter at GoBobbo, GoBobbo. My Trib account is BC_Trib. And on the GoBobbo account, you'll find a lot of Christmas and Days of Our Lives. So I have to say that probably one of my newer favorite Pittsburgh Twitter accounts is the Food Tasters. Just really an interesting account to follow. And I'd have to say nationally, it's probably BuzzFeed. I love all the world of BuzzFeed Twitter accounts. I'm addicted to BuzzFeed.
Awesome.
I'm on Twitter, Instagram, and Tumblr at WPXI Scott, Facebook WPXI Scott Harbaugh. I like anything that's Pittsburgh related. I'm from here, grew up here, came back here, so anything that's Pittsburgh related I like to follow. I do want to say quickly, this has nothing to do with what we're doing, but if you're not staying for the afternoon sessions, there are now more than 50 accidents because of icy roads right now. So Parkway West shut down up near the Beaver Valley Expressway. I-79 at a standstill. Bigelow Boulevard at a standstill. Route 28 not moving right now. So
what are you talking about?
Sorry. That's why I'm not trying to be rude. That's why I've been on my phone so much, because we are literally at a standstill across the city right now.
Wow.
Look at that, public service journalism. That's fantastic. I'm Ethan, E-T-H-A-N, M-A-G-O-C, Magoc, on Twitter, Facebook, whatever. As far as, like, local ones, I would say, Jagoff. Yeah. He's got good stuff. Pittsburgh Dad is always fun, and certainly a second vote for Eat That, Read This, along with Bike Pittsburgh, obviously. If you're a cyclist, it's very good. I think that they are active and have a loyal and committed following there. Nationally, Circa is obviously very good to follow. Trying to change the way news is presented. iHeartPGH is obviously a concern to you, and I think that they're doing interesting things, trying to experiment with that. And that's about it. So,
awesome. Well, thank you to all of you. And I'm on Twitter as Tiki Kate. If you're interested in that, I'm in a band. I'm a speaker too. So I'm actually speaking tomorrow. Yeah. Thank you, guys.